In this session, we are going to work with interface. That's the last feature of object orientation we have already covered so far. Encapsulation and inheritance. That means now we are left with only one feature, that is polymorphism. So let us see how do we implement polymorphism in object orientation with the help of interface as the base topic. Now I first would like to open the figure example which I have done in the previous session of inheritance, where I have a class called as figure, and inherited from figure class we had was circle and square. If a variable is of type figure, we were able to refer to the object of either circle or square, and whatever object we have referred to, accordingly the corresponding method has been invoked. So we would like to do the same thing now. So let us start with the program. As I said, figure, circle, square, area, perimeter. This is what we have seen in the last session of inheritance. Now my target is to convert this figure class into an interface. How to do that? Let us say I can copy and I paste here. I'll replace the keyword abstract class with the keyword interface. Now, by practice, it is a standard of Microsoft that all interfaces will begin with I. So is that done here? Then in interface, every member is automatically public. We don't have to explicitly mention it as public. So we can remove this. And every member is also abstract. All the members of the interface are by default public and abstract. We don't have to explicitly mention them. In interface, we cannot have field members. Instead, we can have properties. And how do we write property then? We have to give here get semicolon set semicolon, indicating that it's a get and set property procedure. So this is now an interface which says it has three members in it. One is dimension, the other is area, and one more, the last is perimeter. We now go about implementing this interface in our class. See, generally what we do is we say a class inherits another class, but here the terminology used is a little different. We will not say a class inherits an interface. The right terminology which we use for the interface is a class implements an interface. So I can say we have class circle and it implements iFigure. That's how we can say that. So now when we say we have class circle and it implements iFigure, it's like a circle class taking the contract of implementing each and every member of the interface iFigure. That means in circle class, we are now supposed to provide area, perimeter, and dimension. Minimum three members. And if required, you can always add extra members. But these three members are compulsory now. So now I give here circle implements area, but we are not overriding. So remove this keyword. Similarly, circle implements perimeter. We are not overriding. Now, what is the additional member which we have to implement in the circle class now? We are only left with dimension. So how to implement it? Click here, public integer dimension, and it should have get block and a set block. Now, properties, we know that they don't hold any data by themselves. So here I will have a private integer underscore circle underscore radius, let us take. Now in get block, I'll say return underscore radius. In set block, I'll say underscore radius is equal to value. So now look at these three members: area, perimeter, dimension. All the three members of the interface are now implemented in the class. That's how we say a class implements an interface. A class has taken the contract of implementing an interface and it has implemented it. Now, let me delete this section. Square, inherits figure. Instead, I would like to write again now class square, and I'll put colon, and I say implements I figure. Now put flower brackets here. This ends the class. Now, how do I implement? Take this studio advantage. Right click on the figure and say implement interface implement. And you get the basic skeleton automatically generated. You have to simply replace this skeleton with the appropriate code. That's not difficult. You can remove this region section. We don't need this. And instead of this, we are going to provide proper implementation. So let us say square. Square will have side. So I can have a private member integer underscore side. So in get block, I'll write return underscore side. In set block, I'll say underscore side is equal to value. Area is what? Underscore side into underscore side. Side into side. That's what is area. And perimeter is 4 into S, that is 4 into side. So it is so easy and simple to implement an interface. Delete. I have a figure, I figure interface. Now implemented by circle and implemented by square. So I just repeat in brief, what is the syntax for implementing an interface? For to start with interface, every member of an interface is by default public. We don't explicitly mention the keyword public with interface members. Second is, every member of an interface is abstract. We cannot have implementation for any member in the interface, and that's the reason interfaces are also referred as pure abstract class. Pure abstract class. A question still remains: when we can have a class and declare all the members as abstract, instead, why should we ever write an interface? By the end of this session, you will get an answer to that question. And now we have got circle, square, both implementing iFigure. Circle is implementing the interface iFigure and thus providing implementation to dimension, area and perimeter. Now what are the rules, syntax rules for implementation? The member of the interface and the member name here must be same. The return type must be same, and this member must be declared as public. So I have public area, public double, and of course public dimension. Same thing we have done here also. So now let's go further. What is the benefit? Benefit is obvious. Now I will have a variable of type interface, which is by default initialized to zero. Now I say that a variable of type interface can refer to an object of a class which implements that interface. In the sense, if a variable is of type iFigure, it can refer to an object of class either circle or square. And based on what it is referring to, the corresponding functionality here is going to be invoked. If figure is referring to circle, this will return the area of circle, and this will return the perimeter of the circle. But if figure is referring to square, these are going to return the area and perimeter of square object. See, what exactly is polymorphism? This is how we actually implement polymorphism. Poly, we very well know, is many. Morphism basically means forms, many forms. But that's not the end of the story. Something very important you have to know about polymorphism is, whenever one thing takes different forms, and each and in each of the form it can take, it will have a common functionality implemented in different way. Then we say it is polymorphic behavior. For example, now let us say I have a method called as eat and I have a fruit. Let us say we have an interface called as fruit. Fruit we eat, that means eat can be a method or behavior in fruit interface. Now what I say is a fruit can be implemented by mango, a fruit can be implemented by banana, a fruit can be implemented by apple. So all the three are fruits. That means if I have a variable of type fruit interface, that variable can refer to either banana